Good day, this is Jim Pytel from Columbia Gorge Community College. This is Digital Electronics. This lecture is entitled Parallel in Shift Registers. So before we begin our discussion about parallel in shift registers, let's talk about a parallel in register. Notice there is no shift occurring for a regular parallel in register. This, however, does not detract from the usefulness of such a device. For example, if you wanted to store a 4-bit number and you did not wish to manipulate it in any way, shape, or form, i.e. shift it any way, shape, or form, you would just use a parallel in register. And what I've drawn here is three different incantations of a parallel in parallel out register. Notice the D's go to the Q's. There is no interaction between Q's of one stage and the other stages. And notice the order in which I've drawn them. The first one on the left is going from MSB to LSB. The one in the middle is going from MSB to LSB. And the third definition, in my opinion, the most useful definition, is just different, okay? And how you apply those things is up to you, okay? Because remember, this orientation from the MSB to LSB or LSB to MSB, it's all relative. It's like the Clackamas County dating scene. Just stay organized. If I wanted to implement a parallel in, parallel out register, in this case a 4-bit, it is astoundingly easy in VHDL. Remember our description for a D flip-flop in VHDL from our previous lectures? It's the exact same description. If clock tick event and clock equals 1, i.e. a positive edge, then Q is assigned D. The only difference is I've assigned Q as a 4-bit vector. I've assigned D as a 4-bit vector. I don't have to do the individual bit assignments when I'm assigning a vector to a vector. It's just dumping whatever was in D into that vector of Q. A parallel in, parallel out register, not a shift register. You may see reputable tech books, otherwise reputable textbooks, trying to tell you that this is a parallel in, parallel out shift register. They're incorrect. That's a parallel in, parallel out register, which, like I said earlier, is still an extremely useful device. But now we're going to talk about parallel in shift registers. There are two different incantations, a parallel in, parallel out shift register and a parallel in serial out shift register. And as you'll see, we will be able to perform the analysis for both parallel out and serial out simultaneously. And basically, it just depends on where we get the outputs from. But for us to create a shift register, we've got to have some interaction between D's and Q stages. In its most basic form, are serial in, serial out shift registers. Basically, the previous stage's Q is feeding the next stage's D. All we want to do is just create an alternate path where we can have parallel inputs. And when it's in load mode, those parallel inputs are being shifted onto those D's. However, when it's in shift mode, the previous stage's Q is the next stage's D. And if we were to have a parallel in, serial out shift registers, what I could do is basically load those things in parallel, the P bits onto the respective Q bits. And then if it was a serial out shift register, where is my output? What's this last stage? In this particular case, it's a shift right shift register. In a general format, what that would look like is this right here. It's got a clock, it's got a clear, it's got parallel inputs, P bits, and it's got a serial out bit. In this particular case, it's the last Q. Notice here, there is a mode command. There are two modes, and they're mutually exclusive. You can either load or you can shift. So it stands to conjecture, given this terminology, which I've done here, shift slash not load. Basically, if it's a 1, it's shifting it, and if it's a 0, it's loading it. Why have I drawn an arrow right here over this first stage P input? Well, typically what happens here is load. Basically, load loads all 4 bits onto those, parallel in. However, when it's in shift mode, where is my input? Typically, it's this one right here. When it's in shift mode, that is our input. Basically, the first stage D has one input, regardless if it's in shift mode or load mode. So let's go ahead and figure out how we can do this. Okay, however, before we do that, I want to actually talk about parallel out. So parallel in, parallel out shift register, it's the exact same definition. The only thing is we're punching a hole in the side, and now we have access to these intermediary stages. Let's go ahead and see how we can actually implement this using some logic. I've taken away the clock and the clear signal. It's just going to go ahead and confuse us. What I've got is this arrangement of AND gates and OR gates on each D input, with the exception of this first stage. Like I said, when it's in shift mode, what is that most leftmost input? Well, it is the parallel bit for that particular stage. When it's in load mode, what is that input? Well, it's the parallel bit for that particular stage. So that input stays the same. And that's right here. That is our serial input, if you wish. Okay, it's constantly active. Whereas if we are in load mode, all four of those are loaded on. And what happens here is this is why I've drawn it in different colors. When it's in shift mode, the red paths are active. When it's in load mode, the blue paths are active. For example, consider a zero being applied to the mode command. So mode zero, basically the load lines are active. What I'm saying is this is now active. It's enabling every single one of these AND gates. What is loaded? Well, everything that's applied to those particular AND gates. That's the input for each stage. Don't have to worry about this one, basically. So when it's in load, those P vector is assigned to the Q vector. What happens when we go to shift mode? Well, the red gates are active. So now mode switches to one. Which AND gates are active? This line is enabling every single one of those AND gates. That stage's Q is being fed to the next stage's D. That stage's Q is fed to the next stage's D. That Q is fed to the next stage's D. And this one we don't have to worry about. It's constantly being fed in there. What is our final output right there? That's our serial output. If we want to go ahead and make this a parallel out, so a parallel in, parallel out shift register, exact same thing. The only thing is we have access to these individual stages right here. That's going to look something like this. So again, in load mode, P is being sent to D. In shift mode, previous stages Q is being sent to the next stages D, and that one doesn't have to work. So long and short of it is a parallel in shift register always has an indication whether I shift or whether I load. Okay, whereas previously, a parallel in register, it was loading every single time a clock happened. Okay, a positive edge on that clock happened. Whereas a parallel in shift register has a mode, whether it's loading or shifting. Okay, so let's go ahead and see if we can do with some of these inside a timing diagram. What I've got here is a parallel in, parallel out shift register, which has a mode selection. When it's the mode is in one, it's shifting. When the mode is in zero, it's loading. And this is for a parallel in, parallel out shift register. How would I make this a parallel in serial out shift register? And the answer is just use this final stage's Q. This is the only out. So there, we can perform the analysis of these simultaneously. Only thing is the parallel outs happen to have those individual stages accessible. Okay, so we've got a mode command. And this is my suggestion to you is just look at the mode command here before you even begin a timing analysis. Load it up, shift it, load it up, shift it. Okay, just get an idea of what's going to be going in there first. And the other thing is just to what are the parallel inputs? So let's go ahead and put some data on those parallel P inputs. So what I've given you guys is some indication of what's on those parallel inputs. And again, using this tabular method here, I can go ahead and say, okay, clock pulse one, I'm going to load it. Clock pulse six, I'm going to load it. All the other ones, I'm going to be shifting. Which direction am I going to shift? I'm going to be shifting right in this particular case. So what happens at clock pulse one? You load it. Zero, one, zero, one. What happens at clock pulse two? We shift it. So this zero goes there. That one goes there. That zero goes there. Where does that one go to? It's gone. The question is, what comes into Q? The red Q. Okay, because there's a lot of Qs there. What comes into red Q is that red P bit, the leftmost P bit. What is the leftmost P bit? It's constantly a zero. So now we go ahead and again, clock pulse three, we shift it. The one goes there, the zero goes there, the zero goes there. What's being shifted in? You guess it. What's on the red Q zero? Zero. We go ahead and shift it again. That one is shifted out, zero, zero, zero. What's shifted in? That red P bit, zero. So go through and see if you can figure out the rest of this table. And then once you've figured out the rest of that table, what you can actually do is take, again, this vertical representation of the red and lay it down on the timing diagram. So first off, let's just do the table. Okay, that's what our timing diagram would look like. Our table would look like. And again, the key thing is here on that six clock pulse, we've reloaded what? Our original inputs for those parallel. And the long story short too is what is coming in when we're shifting? It's constantly that low order P bit, the red PBIC, because we have not defined MSB or LSB. So let's go ahead and, like I said earlier, is just take that original, take the vertical column and just lay it down on the truth table, on the timing diagram here, and your timing diagram for the Q vector should look something like this. And let's assume that they were initially unknown. Let's say that they were initially an unknown value on that particular Q vector, and then we're going to go ahead and load and shift respectfully. They should look something like this. And our timing diagram should look something like this. Okay, so we've had initially an unknown on our respective Q outputs there. What happens at the first clock pulse? We are in loaded mode. So from here, basically, we should see that P vector being loaded onto it. In this particular case, let's read it from left to right. So it's going from 0, 1, 0, 1. What do we have there is 0, 1, 0, 1. As we'd expect. Let's go to the next time it's loaded. It's loaded right there. We should see that same vector 0, 1, 0, 1 being loaded on there. All other times, what's it doing? Shifting, 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 shifting. So it seems relatively easy here, and again, is just to be able to use this tabular format to potentially help you out doing the timing diagram. You don't necessarily need to do that. I find it substantially easier. Okay, like I said earlier, it's all relative about which one's the MSB, which one's the LSB. If we were to go from left to right, what is the number that is stored at clock pulse 7? Left to right, it's 0010. It's 2. What is the same number at that same time frame if we were going from right to left, i.e. the pink one is the MSB? The answer is 0100. The answer is 4. Okay, so it depends. It's all relative. How you use this, it's your choice. So let's go ahead and go into another example, which is exactly the same as the first one. The only thing is I've defined that one as the MSB, this one is the LSB. Let's go ahead and say we're going to load up the following number. This is on the P inputs here. Okay, so that's my P inputs. And just stay organized. First question, what have I loaded? And if you said 10, you're wrong. Look at it. It's this direction, Q3 to Q0. I've loaded 50101. But go ahead and see if you can figure out what the tabular format would look like. Be aware there are times that it's loading and there are times that are shifting. Be aware if it's loading things 2 clock pulses in a row, what would those particular outputs look like if it was loading and loading? So let's go ahead and see what your idea of the tabular format should look like. Okay, so first and foremost, I go ahead and load them at those particular occurrences, the first clock edge, the fourth and the fifth clock edge. And now we're going to go ahead and shift. So I'm shifting this one there, that zero, this one, this one. What comes in to Q0 when it's shifting? Well, the P0 bit. What was the P0 bit? Right here, one. So I'm constantly loading one up every time I'm shifting. What is the remainder of this tabular format look like? It's going to look something like this. Okay, at a certain point, what I'm doing is I'm basically filling up the register with ones. Why? Because of this number right there. It's constantly having a one on its input. What would the timing diagram look like if I take the tabular format and put it in a timing diagram format? Let's go ahead and pretend our state was initially clear. Okay, our entire Q3 to Q0 was clear. What would the timing diagrams look like? They would look something like this. Okay, so here's what our timing diagram looks like. Again, notice I am initially in a clear state. First clock pulse comes along. What am I? I'm in load mode. I'm loading 0101. What happens now? Shift it, shift it, shift it, shift it. And then what happens here? Load it. Okay, 0101. What happens in the fifth clock pulse? Load it again. So basically, it's just static. It's staying there. 0101. So your timing diagram looks a little weird because it's not shifting. It's reloading it. Now, what are we going to do? Shift it, shift it, shift it, and keep on shifting throughout the thing until we get a big old block of ones. And let's do another example of this. And previously, we defined in this one here, it's Q0 to Q3. Let's try the exact same thing. Let's try Q3 to Q0. How is it going to behave? Exactly the same. Okay, so here's another parallel in, parallel out shift register. And notice I have data on Q3 to Q0, and Q3 to Q0 in this particular case is defined from left to right. So how are those stages going to behave? Just like the last two examples, except I've got 3 down to 0. What I've got loaded on it though, notice it's a 0100. So there is data on it. How would this thing behave given the mode command? So it looks like in clock pulse 1 and 2, it's shifting. So we haven't loaded anything. What is going to shift around? Perhaps that original content. What happens at clock pulse 3? Perhaps we load it. 4, what's it going to do? It's going to shift it. What happens at clock pulse 5? Look at this right here. Okay, that mode command goes low between 4 and 5. What happens there? The answer is nothing. Basically, it's going to happen on the 5th clock pulse. It just so happens that the mode command is back to 1, back to shifting. So what I'm trying to do is illustrate with this example, this is a synchronous load. There are such things as asynchronous loads, but beware of this thing is dictated by the clock edges. And let's go through and just see if you can go ahead and figure out what the tabular formats are, okay? And then from there, let's go ahead and take that tabular output and lay it on each one of the timing diagrams and see if we come up with the same example. So what I've done in the tabular method here is I've annotated those individual clock pulses, the 3rd and the 11th at which the P inputs are loaded onto there. And notice here I've given myself an initial condition of 0100. First clock pulse comes along, we are not in load. We are going to shift. What are we going to shift? We're going to shift the initial conditions. Which direction are we shifting? Right. Doesn't matter if it's 3 down to 0 or 0 down to 3, up to 3, we are still shifting right. So what happens is that 0 is shifted there, the 1 is shifted there, 0 is shifted there, this last 0 shifted out. What's shifted in? The answer is this P3 is shifted in, because that is constantly, regardless whether it's in shift mode or load mode, that's being placed there. We are again in shift mode. Second clock pulse, 1 shifts over, 0 shifts over, 0 shifts over. What's being shifted again? P3. Now we load it. What happens now? We shift. What's being shifted in? That P3 bit, 0, 0, 0, all the way through. Let's go ahead and see if you can fill out the tabular format. And that's what that should look like. Notice again, we're loading on clock pulse 3. We're loading on clock pulse 11. Go ahead and take that tabular format, take those vertical columns, lay them down on the timing diagram. You should look like this for Q3 to Q0. And this is what our timing diagram representation should look like. Again, what's happening at that 3rd clock pulse right there? It is loading the number MSB to LSB 0101, as we'd expect from right here. What was initially on it, though, was that 0100. So that, for the first two clock pulses, for 1, and 2, that 1 is being shifted. What's happening for the rest of this? This 1 shifted this way, 0 shifted this way, so on and so forth. What happens on the 11th clock pulse? We are again loading 0101 and then letting it shift from there. So this concludes the lecture about parallel in shift registers. What's the difference between a parallel in and a serial in? Well, basically there are alternate methods to get in there, and you have to either be in load mode or shift mode. They're mutually exclusive. One cannot simultaneously load and shift. What have we done here for a parallel out and a serial out? Well, the only difference is here is this one. This particular case, there would only be one output. For a serial output, it'd be Q0 for this example. However, if it was a parallel output, Q3 through Q0, i.e. all of them, would be available. So let's go into bidirectional shift registers. And we've thus far dealt with examples where we're only shifting right. Maybe we want to be able to shift right or left. So let's go ahead and conclude this section and move on to bidirectional shift registers.